Chapter 1. I am born. Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life, or whether that station will be held by anyone else, these pages must show.
Good morning, Mr. Copperfield. I wonder if...
Seek her through the wild if need be. I'll find her in her shame and bring her back. Nothing will stop me. Nothing.
I ain't afraid of the sea, Davy. Though a cynic cruel.
I'm so sorry. Davy. Don't be angry with me. Please.
Please. Dora. Don't.
Think of me at my best, David. At my best.
I didn't want you to know.
It's no fault of yours, Master David.
Mama. Oh, David.
Is not very clever,
Davy.
Why can't I forget? Forget the past. They're all gone, just shadows. What am I searching for? Myself. To know whether I shall be the hero of my own life. Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life. Whether I shall. Whether.
But if he's gone to Yarmouth, it's because he wants to be by himself.
Stuff and nonsense. Don't I know that child? And don't I know he should not be by himself at this time, after what has happened?
Then you should go.
But I'm his aunt. I should talk to him as an aunt. That's not what he needs. He needs you. After all, you talked for hours together when you were children. Go and talk to him now. I insist. Absolutely.
Be a lady, Emily.
Of course I would, but I'm an orphan, ain't I?
I'm an orphan too, you know, Emily.
It ain't so bad for you, Davy. You got no father, but you got a mama. You got a mama. You got a mama. You got a mama. You got a mama.
Say hello to your new father, Davy. This is Mr. Murdstone. And this is his sister, Miss Murdstone. She's going to live with us too.
If you like, Mrs. Copperfield, I could...
Murdstone. She has a new name now. Mrs. Murdstone. If we need you, Peggotty, is it? We'll call you.
Oh, Davy, don't shame me, my little man.
Now, Clara, have you forgotten our little talk? Firmness.
Firmness.
Firmness is what is wanted. Boys grow with firmness.
Grow.
Davy and I will get along well enough. Won't we, Davy?
Clara, the boys learn to behave.
Oh, oh, ow! Don't please, ow! Ow!
The boy's a biter, and a biter must be taught not to bite.
Davy! Oh, Davy! My precious, my own. Oh, there, there, my pet.
Oh, Peggotty, I didn't think I'd see you.
Oh, you don't think a certain party we both know could stop me saying goodbye to my own Davy, do you? Oh, there, there. School won't be so bad, Davy. Look. Look what I brought you. Now, you get back on the cart. Because I must get back to the house. And I'll write you, Davy. Though I ain't a scholar like you, I'll write you often.
And Peggotty.
And I'll look after your mother. Now, don't you worry none. All right, Mr. Barclays. Now, off you go.
Right.
Goodbye, Peggotty. Goodbye.
Goodbye, Davy.
She made them.
Peggotty, sir.
Uh-huh.
Oh, yes, sir. She makes all our cakes.
No sweethearts.
Sweetmeats, sir.
Sweethearts. Ah, sweethearts. That there, Peggy.
Oh, no. Oh, no, sir.
No. Perhaps you might be writing to her.
Oh, yes, sir. I certainly shall.
In that case, perhaps you'd recollect the say. Barkers is willing.
Barkers is willing?
Ah, that's it. Barkers is willing. That's all.
Why, yes, sir. Of course, sir. Barkers is willing.
Thanks. What's your name, young fellow?
Copperfield, sir.
Any left? You're sure you want me to have it?
Yes, sir.
Good for you, Copperfield. I'm Steerforth. This is Traddles. Traddles, Copperfield. Come on. You're to see old Creakle, I suppose. What money have you got, Copperfield?
7 shillings, sir.
Perhaps I'd better take care of it. You're sure you want me to have it?
Yes, sir.
Good for you, Copperfield. Perhaps you'd like to spend a couple of shillings on currant wine.
Almond cake.
And then there's fruit, of course.
Chocolate cream biscuits.
Look here, Traddles. This is his money, you know.
Sorry, Steerforth.
Don't worry about him. I'll look after you.
Hello?
Who are you? Who are you?
Copperfield, sir.
Copperfield, Mr. Creakle.
Ah, the Murdstone boy. The biter. We know how to deal with biters here. Approach me, boy.
Right, boy, right.
Can you read, boy?
Yes, sir.
What does the card say then?
Beware this dog. He bites. Have you got a dog, sir?
Has he got him? There's the dog, Mr. Tuggies. There's the dog, I see.
There's the dog.
Now understand me, boy, because I'm a Tartar. When I say I'll do a thing, I'll do it. And when I say I'll have it done, I will have it done.
I will.
When I see you, I want to see the card. No matter where, no matter when, I see you, I see the card. Because I'm a Tartar boy, a real Tartar. And if I see you and don't see the card, I'll have your heart for meat pudding. Now you know me. And I know you, you see?
Struggles. I think you've worn this long enough.
You can't do that, Steerforth.
Why not, Traddles?
Mr. Creakle put it there.
And I'm taking it off.
Creakle!
Touch me, boy.
Nice boy, approach!
What am I, boy?
A Tartar, sir.
I see you. I see the card, remember? Where's the card?
I took the liberty of removing it.
That was indeed a liberty, Steerforth. A very great liberty. Perhaps you had a good reason.
I think so.
Would you like to tell her?
Certainly. It seemed to me that this young fellow was getting a good deal too much protection from that card. By virtue of the angle at which the cane falls, the cane was not having its proper effect.
Now, that is something I confess that had not occurred to me. I'm much obliged to you, Steerforth.
Not at all.
Back to your seat, boy. The Lord is my shepherd this morning, Mr. Sharp.
On my shepherd, Mr. Sharp.
Boys, boys, boys!
Bravo, Steeple! Bravo!
That's enough.
Your services will not, of course, be needed here any longer. I believe you have a brother in Yarmouth. I suggest you go there.
Oh, but sir...
Out!
You know where to find me, my love. I'll always be there.
Come here. I've been thinking about you since your poor mother is no longer with us. It is my unfortunate duty to do that alone. Education is costly. And even if it were not, I am of the opinion that your character would be better formed in a struggle with the world at large.
Stubbornness won't do. It needs to be crushed.
I intend, therefore, to put you to work. Your school days are over. You have heard me speak, no doubt, of the wine merchants, Murdstone and Grinby. We have our warehouse in the City of London, down by the river. We use a great many bottles in the course of our business and employ a number of boys to clean and polish them. I see no reason why you should not be one. You will work from 7 in the morning till 8 at night. Your lodging I have provided for.
You sleep in your own time. This is Mr. Micawber. You're to lodge with him.
Under the impression that your peregrinations in this metropolis have not as yet been extensive, allow me to assist you in penetrating this modern Babylon as far as my residence in the City Road. In short, I shall be happy to show you the way. And that, my dear Copperfield, is the rule I have lived by in the proverbial nutshell. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £19.19. Result, happiness. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £20.06. Result, misery. And so, my dear Copperfield.
Master Copperfield, I cannot disguise the fact that Mr. Micawber's affairs have come to a crisis. Apart from the heel of a Dutch cheese, which is not adapted to the needs of a young family, there is not a thing to eat in the house.
Oh, come, my dear, I'm sure if we all look, something will turn up. Something always will turn up, you know.
There's a Mr. Mortimer to see you. He's down there. Make it quick.
Mr. Mortimer, sir. Mr. Micawber.
My dear Copperfield, the penetration of your vision is unnerving.
But by the disguise.
I'm being hunted, my dear friend, hunted by that most savage of all creatures, the creditor. Your thing. My dear young friend, at present, and until something turns up which I'm hourly expecting, I've nothing to bestow but advice. I've heard you speak of your great aunt in Dover. My advice is, seek her out. My dear friend. Farewell.
Mother died, they've beaten me and put me to work.
No, 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 stop the crying. Stop the boo-hooing, I won't have it. Do you hear? I won't have it.
Yes, Aunt.
What on earth am I to do with you? Ran away, you say? Well, look at you. Look at the state you're in. Mercy on us. I don't know. What's a body to do?
Oh, please, don't send me back, Aunt.
No, no, no. Listen, a decision cannot be altered at the sound of a child's crying, not at all. Absolutely not. So now be quiet. I must think. Mr. Dick! Mr. Dick! Mr. Dick will advise us. That man's mind is a miracle of clarity. Mr. Dick, you've heard me mention David Trotwood Copperfield.
David
Oh, to be sure, David. Cop.
Well, this is he. And he's done a pretty bit of mischief. He's run away. Because that's the kind of foolishness that any boy might do. Now, the question I want to put to you is, what am I to do with him?
Do with him?
Do with him. Now, I shall ask you for some very sound advice. This is a very serious matter.
If I were you, I should wash him.
Ah, Mr. Dixence is all right. That man's mind is a miracle. Now, Trot, for that's what I shall call you, Trotwood Copperfield from now on. Into the house, off with your clothes. Janet, heat the bath.
You shouldn't have come, Agnes. You shouldn't have come. How is my aunt?
She's well.
And Mr. Dick?
Still flying his kite.
Oh, Agnes, I have missed you all. I truly have.
Well, your aunt wonders why, when you're back in England, you've not been home. It's 3 years since you went away.
Going home is no solution. I can't think, I can't write anymore.
David, you know, you can't go on blaming yourself for everything, for the past, for Steerforth and for Dora. All those years when your Aunt Betsy sent you to live with us. You called me a little sister, remember? Well, we used to be able to talk to each other then.
It's all a nightmare, Agnes.
Yes, but sometimes it's better to expose a wound to the open air.
The Peggotty's houseboat. What's left of it? It all started there. Festered there and destroyed itself there. You'll love the Peggotty, Steerforth. They're good, kind, simple folk, and they don't pretend to be anything else.
Oh, I dare say their skins are rougher than their natures. Well, come on, let's see these paragons of virtue.
Dear Paul.
Davy!
Davy,
Michael!
Davy!
Master Davy! By and large, so that's what I am if this don't top everything.
Mr. Peggotty.
And Emily. Little Emily. Goodness, how you've grown.
Are you both grown?
Welcome, Master Davy.
Ham.
It's good to see you.
Oh, this is good.
And who is that sitting there so quiet behind you? I bet you don't recognize that Holden, huh?
Marcus is willing.
I still am. Hello, Master Davy.
Hello, Mr. Marcus.
Well, stab me if we ain't the rudest of them all. Here's Master Davy brings this young gentleman down to see us, and we leave him standing there like a fish out of water.
Then a fish must have more than one element, Mr. Peggotty, for I feel perfectly at home.
That's kindly said, sir.
Steerforth, I am sorry.
Not another word. This is my old school friend, Mr. Steerforth.
Oh, leave me do the honors, Master Davy. Mr. Steerforth, and those who are welcoming you to our home is as follows. My sister Clara, her husband, Mr. Barkis, my Emily, and my nephew Ham. And my plain self, as is called, Daniel Peggotty.
And very glad I am to know you.
Come now, sit you down, sir, and you too, Master Davy. Because I've got something to tell you, it just won't keep inside of me a moment longer. How you two gentlemen come to be here on this day of all days, I'll never know. For if it ain't the brightest of my life, I'm a shellfish. Boiled, too. This here little Emily, as you see, a blush in here just now, sir, ain't my child. I never had one. But I couldn't love her more if she wore. You understand?
I do, indeed.
And this great tarpaulin of a chap as is standing there beside her and has known her since a child from living in the same house with her. What's he going to do but lose his heart to her?
Uncle Daniel.
No, Emily, come back.
Go fetch her back, Ham.
Emily.
Loses his heart, I say.
And she's accepted him?
Just before you come in. And 2 years, mind, after he first asked her.
Emily, I'm delighted. We couldn't have come at a better time. Mr. Peggotty, I couldn't be more happy for you.
I don't know how long I may live or how soon I may die, Master Davy.
Oh, Daniel, stop talking so gloomy.
Nevertheless, 'tis true. I could capsize any night in a gale of wind. And if I could see the town lights shining for the last time over the rollers as I couldn't make no head against, I'd go down quieter, thinking, there's a man ashore who's iron true to my Emily. And no wrong can touch her while he lives.
Mr. Peggotty, you're a thoroughly good fellow and deserve to be as happy as you are today. That's my hand.
Oh.
My boy, I give you joy. Is my hand on that, too.
Thank you, sir. She's more to me than ever I can say. I love her true. There ain't a man in all the land or sailing on the sea could love her more.
I can see that. And I can see she's worth it. Emily, I wish you joy.
Thank you.
And what is this I happen to have in my pocket? Why, it's nothing less than a full flask of French brandy, which, if the ladies will permit, we gentlemen will split between us.
Oh, bravo, Steerforth.
I'll fetch the glasses, Davy. There's biscuits in the tin.
I'll get them down.
God bless you, Emily. It's what I always wanted, but never dared hope for. I can rest happy now, knowing that no matter what happens to me, no harm shall come to my Emily. None.
Mr. Peggotty? Baby? I'll give you a toast. To the happy couple. May they live long and multiply.
There, Steerforth. Have you ever seen such simple goodness?
Oh, engaging enough, I agree. He's a chuckle-headed fellow for a girl, though, isn't he?
Steerforth, you joke about everything, but I know it's without malice.
There really is a goodness in you, Davy. I wish to heaven there were in all of us.
Agnes Wickfield, friend. What are you? A saint on some errand of mercy?
No. No, David.
Why really did you come?
Your Aunt Betsy was worried about you. After all that had happened, your strange letter.
Aunt Betsy. You should run, Agnes. You're a fool to stay.
Do you want me to leave?
No. No.
Then talk to me about it. About the voices you hear and the faces you see. Tell me.
They haunt me, Agnes. And yet it's as if I wanted them to. Wanted them to punish me for all the things I'd left undone.
Undone? What else could you have done?
I could have loved Dora more.
And Steerforth less. Yes, that you might have done. There was no truth in him from the start. It seemed so plain, and yet you worshipped him. Why?
You should have seen him at school. He was like a king. He was a good angel.
He was your bad angel. Cold.
My friend, I think you are both quite drunk. I have led you astray.
Beautiful.
The whole world seems to be going round and round.
Well, it is going round and round, you have.
Ridiculous.
Funny, I never noticed it before.
Nor the amount of my wine that you have both consumed.
Why, Master Copperfield, what a pleasure and a privilege to see you once again, sir. I should have called, say, Mister, but the other comes so natural.
Agnes. Oh, bless me. Agnes.
I think you should go home, David.
Absolutely. First, allow me to present two trusty companions from my school days. Mr. James Mr. James Steerforth and Mr. Tommy Chuddles. Gentlemen, I would like you to meet my oldest and dearest friend, Miss Agnes Wickfield. Father, Mr. Wickfield, and their clerk, Hugh Rye.
Oh, what an unforgettable evening this has become, Master Copperfield. And what a prophet you have proved yourself to be.
Beg your pardon.
Who'd have thought it likely, sir? Certainly not an humble person like myself.
Pray don't keep us in such suspense, Mr. Heap.
Mr. Heap refers to the fact that I discussed this morning making him a partner.
A partner? Don't you recall Master Copperfield saying to me once, years ago, that this might happen if I applied myself to work? When a person is humble, Master Copperfield, a person treasures such things up.
Well, congratulations. You're not quite so humble as you imagine.
I am very humble to the present moment, Master Copperfield. But Wickfield and Deep, could it ever happen?
Well, if you will excuse us, I think you should go home, David.
Yes, if you will excuse us, Master Copperfield, this has been a truly memorable evening.
Who on earth is that curious creature?
Hmm? It's Uriah Heep, a cringing villain, if ever there was one, who will stop at nothing until he has the Wickfield under his thumb. I'm afraid for her, Steerforth. Afraid for Agnes.
Heep, you crazy villain! We defy you! Do you hear me? Heep, defy you!
Steerforth! Wait for me!
Me too, Heep!
I can hear you, Heap, slinking through the night, you slimy creature!
Found you at last!
Look out, Heap! I'm coming!
You're mad!
Heap, we defy you! And all your friends in villainy!
We definitely do, Heap! We defy you! Where would I be without you, Steerforth?
At home. In bed. Decently sober and decently sleeping. Promise me this, dearie. If something should ever separate us, you'll think of me at my best. Promise me. Promise me.
You have no best for me, Steerforth. And no worst. You are always equally loved.
Good for you! Show yourself, please!
Ha, 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 ha,
Me, about my life. What is my life? Is it just a series of accidents, or is there a deeper meaning to it all? My childhood. Steerforth. Dora. Dora. So secure in her own fragile world, I should have left her there. Left her there. With all his talents, life unrolled itself for him like a red carpet every step of the way. Except the last. Why? Why?
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
Copperfield! Steerforth! I didn't expect to see you here.
Oh. I came down to sail my boat. Do you like her? Yes. Bought her a few weeks ago. Come for a sail.
No, I can't. I've come down to see Barkus. He's dying.
Yes, I've heard.
Come with me. We can talk as we go.
Well, they'd all be there. I feel out of place.
Oh, nonsense.
All right. But let me sail you down.
It's a long way round.
Come on, climb aboard.
All right, I will. You come down here often?
Yes. I've taken a fancy to this place.
I didn't know you had this passion for the sea.
It's an Englishman's birthright, Davy. I've just discovered it. You should come down more often.
I have to work. My apprenticeship cost my aunt a lot of money.
You're far too responsible, Davy, even for a budding proctor. Life is there for the taking, you know? Hold that. Pretty name, isn't it?
Yes.
Why, Mr. Davy, well, it's good of you to come. Good of you to come all this way.
And you too, sir.
Come in, come in.
How is he?
He'll be going out with the tide.
With the tide?
People don't die here along the coast until the tide's pretty nigh out. They don't get born till it's pretty nigh in. Not properly born till flood.
Welcome, Master Davy.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Steerforth?
Emily, look who's come to cheer us up, Can't bear the sorrow of this, Master Davy. She's taken it harder than all of us, excepting Peggotty, of course. You're too tender a heart, haven't you, my beauty? Em, look after your intended. I'm going to tell your aunt that Master Davy's here.
Will you have a chair, Mr. Staple?
Thank you.
Peggotty said in her letter that you've had to postpone the wedding.
No. Still, we got the rest of our lives ahead of us.
Seems little enough to do out of respect to them that's coming to the end of theirs. She also said that you've taken a very nice little house. It is nice, Master Davy. If you'll allow us while you're here, we'd like to show it to you.
I'd like that.
Davy. Davy.
Peggotty. I am sorry.
I'm so glad you could come. If he comes round, it'd cheer him up to see you. My Barkis always admire you, Davy.
Look. Look, Mr. Steerforth came down with me.
Oh, that's good of you, Mr. Steerforth.
My sympathies, Peggotty.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I think we should all go in now. Won't you come with us, Emily?
Please. We don't want to see him.
Emily!
Oh, there, there, child. You stay here, I understand. She'll remember him as he used to be. It's best that way.
I'll wait here, then.
Tide is going out.
Barkis, my dear. Here's my own dear boy come to see you. My dear boy that brought us together. That you sent messages by. Barkis. Barkis.
No, woman. How better woman anywhere? Claire Peggotty. Barkis. There's the name.
Barkis. Look, Master Davy's come down to see you.
Perhaps you might be writing to her.
Yes, Mr. Barkis. I should be writing to her.
Barkis is willing. Barkis is willing. They're both of them going out fast. Him and the tide.
What do you see there?
You come on me like some reproachful ghost.
I call you down from the stars?
No, up from hell. I wish to God 1,000 times over your poor Daniel Peggotty or his chocolate-headed nephew, anyone but me. I wish with all my soul I'd been better guided. I wish with all my soul I could guide myself better.
Steerforth, what is it?
Nothing. Nothing. Fancies, that's all. I'm heavy company for myself sometimes.
Barkis is dead.
The sun sets every day for someone. We must ride on. Rough shod if need be, smooth shod if that will do. On and on, over everything, win the race.
What race is that?
Why? The one we're all in. The one we enter from the start.
I'm going back to the inn. You joining me?
You don't need joining, Davy. I've never known anyone so well put together as you.
He did well for you, Peggotty. He left you well provided for.
He was always so tight with money. I can see now why he was. And I used to quarrel with him something terrible over it.
You done your duty by him and he knowed it. and he done his by you. And that's as it should be.
Where's Emily? She's mentioned in the will. I can't start without her.
Oh, she'll be here shortly. You're wondering what that's for, eh, Davy? Why, I put that candle in the window for our little Emily. You see, the path there's not over light.
You worry too much about her.
You may be right, but I always done it, and I don't doubt I'll go on so.
Even when she's wed?
Oh, when she's wed, that's different, but I tell you something, Master David, like as not, I'll still go on putting that candle in the window and pretend that I'm expecting her. Here she is. Where's Emily?
Master Davy, will you come outside a minute? I've got something I want to show you.
Ham, what's the matter? Where's Emily?
She's gone.
Gone? Gone where?
She runned away. She left it. What am I going to tell him, Master Davy? How am I going to tell him?
Things old Bark has collected. What is it? What's happened?
She's gone, Mr. Piketty. She's run away.
No. Emily? My Emily?
Davy, perhaps she's just gone to a friend. Perhaps.
Read it. Read it to me.
When you who love me better than I deserve see this, I shall be far away. Oh, if you knew how my heart is torn. If ever you that I have wronged so much that never can forgive me could only know what I suffer. Tell Uncle that I never loved him half so dear as now. Don't remember how affectionate and kind you have all been to me. Ham, don't remember we were ever to be married. Love some good girl who will be true to you and worthy of you, and know no shame but me. When I leave you all tonight, it will be never to return unless he brings me back a lady. God bless all. My last tears. My last thanks for Uncle.
Oh, God.
Who is it? I want to know his name.
Master Davy, go out a bit. Let me tell him what I must.
Steerforth.
Steerforth. This ain't no fault of yourn, Master Davy. I ain't a lying of it to you.
Steerforth. He done this to her. Scheming viper. Told her tales of what he'd do for her. Filled her head with fancies, not caring what happened to her, excepting he got his way.
Where are you going?
Going to seek my niece. I'm going to seek my Emily.
Daniel, there's nothing you can do now.
You know what she'd become when he finished with her. She's lost.
I want that candle lit every night. If any harm should come to me before I find my Emily, say to her, the last words I left her was, I forgive her. I'll find her, wherever she is, whatever she's become. I'll find her, I'll seek her through the world if need be. I'll find her in her shame and bring her back. Nothing will stop me. Nothing.
Trotwood, if he's gone to Yarmouth, it's because he wants to be by himself.
Stop the nonsense, child. Don't I know that? And don't I know he shouldn't be by himself after all that's happened?
I cannot go. I can't leave my pupils, my school. Besides, it's clear from his letter that he wants to be left alone. We should respect that.
It's a pity he's not a girl. He'd be much more inclined to do as he's told and come home. As a matter of fact, he should have been a girl. His mother distinctly led me to expect that he would be a girl. If he'd been a girl, none of this would have happened.
Dear Miss Trotwood, he's himself, David Copperfield, whom we both love as a friend. Nonsense! Nonsense! Yes. Yes. I have hoped all these years he'd think of me differently. But he doesn't, and I've come to terms with it, and now it doesn't hurt anymore. But it's cost me, Miss Trotwood, it's cost me. And I've no wish to start paying all over again.
Well, in that case, go as a friend. Go for my sake. He should not be alone this time, Agnes. Should not.
I love the sea. Its challenge is constant. It makes no demands. It asks nothing of you. You can just stand and watch it. And then in the end, your spirit moves in sympathy with it.
They're so young.
This is Mr. Copperfield. We like Mr. Copperfield.
Do you really?
Yes. Jippy's very fond of you, aren't you, Jippy? Or at least he was until he sat next to that awful Miss Kit this afternoon.
But I couldn't avoid it. You could see that, surely, couldn't you?
Nasty Miss Kit. She doesn't like us, does she, Jippy?
But I thought she was a very good friend of yours. I can't stand her. Dora. Dora, couldn't you just put Jip down for a moment?
Oh, poor Jippy. I think he doesn't like you, Jip.
Oh, I do, really. I do. It's just that I... Oh, Dora, just put him down for a minute. I must talk with you. Dora, I love you. Jip! I've loved you so completely and for so long, I need you. I want you forever. Jip! If you say that you don't love me, I don't know what I'll do. Jip! Please, Dora, tell me that... Jip! Tell me that you love me. Ow!
Oh, Josie. Yes. Yes.
This time, Traddles, are you really studying law?
Absolutely. And you're getting married, young Copperfield?
Yes.
Splendid. This is where I live.
Thieves! Robbers!
Oh dear, more trouble.
I know your kind. Well, there's no more milk until you pay up. Lively nights.
The cobble! Let go! Oh! The cobble! No! Have I deserved this?
Leave me, my love, leave me. Let me write finish for that miserable book of life they call Wilkins Micawber.
My love, if your creditors will not give you time, they must take the consequences.
What's happening?
Blood cannot be obtained from a stone, Mr. Traddles. Neither can anything on account be obtained at present from Mr. Micawber.
Mr. Micawber? It's David Copperfield.
Is it possible? Why, once more, behold, Copperfield, friend of my youth, companion of my earlier days.
Master Copperfield! Copperfield.
Mrs. McCall, good heavens, you know each other.
The Traddles should be living here of all things. How are you both?
You find us, my dear friend, in the very best of health.
Not entirely, my love.
Mrs. Micawber refers, I'm happy to say, to a probable addition to the infantine group. My dear Copperfield will, of course, be joining us for dinner.
My love, join us? He may. But as for dinner, we'd all be better off joining someone else.
My dear Copperfield, this is luxurious, what it is to have an aunt in Dover. Your style of living reminds me of my bachelor days, which brings me to my fifth toast of the evening, to your approaching connubial bliss.
Not before time.
To learn that your life is about to be sanctified by the influence of woman in the lofty character of wife completes my euphoria. In short, I am delighted. To the happy couple.
The happy couple.
The happy couple.
May they live long and be always united. Mrs. Micawber, another glass.
A thimbleful, Mr. Traddles. Not since I lived with dear Papa have I had the opportunity of sampling so fine a vintage.
My love, I detect a note of sad regret in that remark.
Micawber, have I deserved this? I, who never have deserted you, who never will desert you.
Pray, Mrs. Micawber, don't distress yourself.
No, Miss Spenlow. It's of no use asking me. I never will desert Mr. Micawber, never.
Mr. Micawber, what line of business are you in at present?
I'm engaged, my dear Copperfield, in the sale of corn upon commission.
A gentlemanly avocation, but hardly remunerative. A situation that Mr. Micawber is about to remedy.
Is that so, Mr. Micawber?
My dear, there are times when one needs to take a pause, to fall back, so to speak, to take what can only be termed a spring.
Absolutely.
You find me, dear friend, fallen back for the spring. I'm about to make a most vigorous leap.
In which direction?
My dear Traddles, the responsibility for the profligate waste of my talent lies with society. I shall make that waste known to society by the simple device of advertising it in the newspapers. I shall challenge society to set that wrong to rights. Throw down the gauntlet, as it were, and say, in effect, show me who will pick it up. Let the party immediately step forward.
Aunt Betsy, what are you doing here?
Well, I'm ruined, Trot. I'm ruined. That's what I'm doing here. I've lost everything. I've nothing left in the world except what you see. Well, God help you now, Trot, for I no longer can.
Are you sure, Aunt, that you'll not have wine? You always do.
Wine is too expensive, Trot. We must stick to ale from now on.
Now, tell me everything that has happened.
Well, really, there's not much to tell. As you know, all my money was invested for me by Agnes's father. When he took that writhing creature Heap into the firm, nothing seemed to go right. They made a mess of everything, including my money.
I shall make an end of my apprenticeship and try to get back the money you had to pay.
Trot, if you do that, it will be the end between us.
But, Aunt, it was such a lot of money.
My dear child, if I have any object in life at all, it is to see you set up. I'm bent on it. And so is Mr. Dick. Aren't you, Mr. Dick?
Well, then, I shall find other work. We will not starve, I promise you.
Oh, goodness, Trot. If that foolish child, your mother, could see you now, she'd cry her eyes out. She'd be so proud of you. But then she always was a baby. She cried at everything. Now, tell me, how is your newfound love going to take your newfound poverty?
His nose is definitely warm, Dodie. I think he's sickening for something.
Dora, my love, you haven't answered my question.
But how can you ask me anything so foolish? Could I love a beggar?
But I am one.
Oh, don't be so silly, Dodie. I'll set Jip on you. Go on, Jip. Bite him, bite him.
Listen, my sweet.
If you're going to talk about being poor and working hard...
But I am poor.
Do you mean that Jip can't have his mutton chop every day?
Well...
Oh, Dodie, he must have his mutton chop every day.
Very well. He'll have his mutton chop every day. Even if it means that I have the bones. May I suggest something?
Yes, but don't be practical.
I have to be, sweetheart. I don't want to alarm you, but perseverance and strength of character will be of great help to us.
I don't understand what you're trying to say, Dodie. Now do take Jip and be agreeable.
Well, Jip, it looks as though you're going to have to provide us with all your old bones.
Tell Miss Trotwood that her nephew has come for her. Mr. Micawber, what on earth are you doing here?
My dear Copperfield, I've hourly been expecting you since the arrival of that gracious lady, your aunt, who's comfortably installed inside.
But are you working here in Canterbury?
I am, sir, in the capacity of confidential clerk to Mr. Uriah Heep. Oh.
Well, I'm blessed. So society took up the challenge after all. How's the family?
Mrs. Micawber and I have moved into the older house of the Uriah Heep, that gentleman now being installed in the house of the Wickfields.
And how do you like law?
Oh, the mind is not allowed to soar to any exaggerated extent. Still, the law is a great pursuit, and Heep has been generous.
I would not have thought it.
I speak as I find, of course, as I've found him ever ready to lend a sympathetic ear to that legacy of pecuniary embarrassments that accompanied us here.
Oh, this is a pleasure and a privilege, Master Copperfield. I should say Mr. Copperfield, but I know you'll excuse the habit. I've got interest there.
How are you, Uriah?
All the better for being asked, Master Copperfield. You needn't wait, Micawber. They expect you at the courts to pick up documents. What a tragedy has overtaken your aunt, Master Copperfield. I was sickened to hear of it.
Oh, we shall survive.
I hear you've moved into the Wickfields' house. Yes. So much more convenient. I occupy your old room, you know. All stratagems are fair in love, sir.
Love?
To be near the object of one's affection, sir. Even the humblest of us may aspire to.
You don't seriously imagine that Miss Wickfield...
Oh, no, sir, not seriously imagine. I'm far too humble for that, but seriously hope, sir. Why not? Miss Agnes is very grateful for what I've been able to do for her father.
Oh, is she?
For I am hopeful I have been the instrument of good to Mr. Wickfield. Oh, what a worthy man he is, Master Copperfield, but how imprudent he has been.
Field, imprudent, you...
If anyone else had been in my place these past few years, he'd have had Mr. Wickfield under his thumb. Under his thumb.
Ah, Trot, there you are. Well, this sorry business is concluded. I'm as poor as I thought. Let us be on our way.
Oh, Miss Trotwood, what an absolute delight and a privilege and pleasure.
Just take it, will you? Keep still. Don't be galvanic, sir. If you're an eel, say so. If you're a man, control your limbs. Good God. I will not be serpentined and corkscrewed out of my senses.
I do most humbly beg your pardon, Miss Trotwood. Did you have Miss Trotwood sign the conveyancing deeds for the cottage?
No, I'm afraid I...
Dear, dear. Forgetful, aren't we? Top drawer.
Yes?
What's this I hear from Heap? That man has evil intentions.
Oh, let's not talk of him. Tell me about you.
About me. Agnes, I'm in love. I'm in love with the most wonderful girl in the world.
Who is she?
Her name is Dora Spenlow. And I want you to meet her as soon as possible and tell me what you think of her.
Why? Will it make any difference?
No, I just want to hear you go into raptures about her.
Oh, David, I am so happy for you.
We're ready to leave, Trot.
Yes, I'm just coming.
Son and God the Holy Ghost, bless, preserve, and keep you. The Lord mercifully with his favor look upon you, and so fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace, that you may so live together in this life, and in the world to come, ye may have life everlasting. Amen.
Evening, Porter.
Evening, John.
Evening.
The last person that I expected to see here.
Well, I had occasion to be in Norwich on a case this morning and decided to return to London by way of Yarmouth. Miss Trotwood told me that you and David were here.
It's so good to see you.
Well, where is our distinguished author?
He went out for some fresh air.
Well, you'll certainly find it out there. Miss Trotwood showed me his letter. I wish there was something I could do. I heard from him while he was in Switzerland, but I'd hoped his trip abroad would help him forget, but... Steerforth, Dora. It all seems to have happened such a long time ago. How hard this must be for you.
I start feeling sorry for myself now. Nothing will be accomplished except more tears. And there's been enough of those.
Does he know you're in love with him? I've known you both a long time, you know. You are in love with him, aren't you? He's such a fool.
Traddles, he's so alone.
You're wondering what that's for, eh, Davy? I put that candle in the window for our little Emily. You see, the path ain't over light or cheerful out there after dark. Master Davy, this is you.
Mr. Peggotty.
I've been a long way, Master Davy. A long way. It'll take too long to tell you all the places I've been. But right through France. Down as far as Italy.
I curse the day I took you to Yarmouth. I shall never forgive myself.
One thing I can tell you, though. She's no longer with him.
You mean she's left him?
Well, as far as I can make out, he left her, which don't surprise you or me.
Poor Emily.
Anyway, losing track of him, I traveled home. But I found a letter waiting for me at Yarmouth from some place in the south of France. There was money in it. Money he'd left her, for she had none. And the note begging for forgiveness and saying she'd never come home.
Where do you think she'd go?
It's hard to say, but what I think is she might find herself here in London and... Well, it ain't no use disguising, Master Davy, what's most likely to happen to her. Well, oh, Master Davy, what's your news, eh?
Mine. Well, I'm married.
God bless me, there's a thing. Married, are you?
Yes, and we're expecting our first.
Then you oughtn't to be sitting here talking with me, but be home along of her. Come on now. It's done me a power of good seeing you, Master Davy.
Goodbye, Davy.
You must keep Chip off the table. He's unhealthy.
Oh, I do try, Dodie, but he's such a naughty little thing.
Cold supper tonight?
Oh, no. Lamb chops baked in the oven and roast potatoes.
I don't smell anything cooking.
I don't think Marianne started it, Chip. Oh, Dodie, don't be cross.
Dora, this won't do. It really won't. It happens every night. You must speak to her.
Oh, no. No, Dodie, don't ask.
But you must. It's your house.
But you know she never listens to me.
She will never have any respect for you if you...
Mr. Micawber.
You may show me the door, if you wish.
Mr. Micawber, what a...
Sir, I'm a straw upon the surface of the deep, tossed in all directions.
Are you in debt?
Mr. Copperfield, when I was in debt, I could look my fellow man in the face today, when I enjoy a superfluity of sufficiency. I and my fellow men are no longer on those terms. Madam.
Mr. Micawber. I hope that Mrs. Micawber and the family are well.
I hope so, ma'am, for since Mrs. Micawber will no longer speak to me, I've no more news of her than you have.
Mr. Micawber, what exactly is the matter?
Villainy is the matter. Baseness, deception, fraud. Conspiracy of the matter, and the name of the whole atrocious mess is Heap.
Heap? But I didn't understand. I thought you were doing so well there.
Too well, sir. But I'll lead this life no longer. I'm a wretched creature, cut off from my dearest friends. Give me back my wife, sir. Give me back my friends. Give me back my peace of mind.
My dear friend.
No, no. I put my hand in no man's hand till I have blown to fragments that detestable serpent. He forgot what's most important. Be prepared, sir.
Prepared for
an
what?
An instant summons, sir, from me to you, sir, to the offices of Wickfield and Heap, sir.
But when?
Next week, next month, next year. But the time will come.
Go to Mr. McCall. Please, you will stay and eat with us, of course. Laura, tell Mary Ann to put another chop in the oven.
Dodie, there isn't one.
Well, then tell her to carve some cold bacon. Don't tell me that there are no cold meats in the house.
My dear Copperfield, I'll partake of no man's hospitality till I have moved Vesuvius to eruption on that abandoned rascal. Heap!
Two miserable chops. Is that all we've got in this house?
I didn't know he was coming.
You've embarrassed and humiliated me.
You told me not to waste.
Can't you use your common sense? Are you totally incapable of doing anything?
Yes. Yes, I am. I'm incapable. I'm useless and girlish, but that pleased you once. You loved me for it.
You're incapable, Clara. Now, give Jane the keys to the house.
I try.
Clara, you're pretty, as everyone knows, but thoughtless too. And the house is not your strong point. Now, give Jane the keys.
Forgive me, love. Forgive me.
Oh, Dodie. Dodie.
David, I'm off to bed now. Shall I see you in the morning before I leave?
Yes, of course. I'm sorry.
Ah, nonsense. Good night, Agnes.
Thank you.
I hope I didn't seem rude.
He understood.
I married her because she was pretty. Because she was weak and helpless. And then I wanted to change her. Why? Why? Because all my life I loved and hated what was pretty and what was useless.
Oh, Dodie. Oh, Davy.
Loved and hated the careless, irresponsible world of Steerforth and Dora, yes, and even of my mother. Desired it, yet despised it. The pretty shape without substance, the tinsel people of the world who glitter for a while yet fall to pieces when you touch them.
Oh, Dodie, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
Yes, I even wanted the child that was born dead, in the hope that it would change her. Make a woman of her.
left her. She isn't strong enough.
She wanted you to go trapped. It gave her pleasure. Mr. Micawber, we are here.
Miss Trotwood, Miss Agnes Wickfield, Mr. David Copperfield, Mr. Thomas Traddles, and Mr. Dick.
Oh, this is indeed an unexpected pleasure, Master Copperfield. I hope to see you well, sir. And Miss Trotwood, I am honored, ma'am.
As I remember, this used to be Mr. Wickfield's office.
Things have changed in this office, Miss Trotwood, since I was an humble clerk. But I am not changed.
No, sir. You seem to be pretty constant to the promise of your youth. If that's any comfort to you.
Oh, thank you, Miss Trotwood. This is a pleasure, is it not, Miss Agnes? You needn't wait, Micawber. And how is Mrs. Copperfield? We have been alarmed by reports of her poor health. Micawber. Did you hear me tell you not to wait?
I did.
Then why do you wait?
Because I, in short, choose.
Oh, I see. This is a conspiracy. You have met here by appointment.
Mr. Micawber, I think you may proceed.
So, you've got your little spies in the office then, have you, Copperfield? Well, you know, conspiracy is an offence in law.
We know the law well enough, Mr. Heap. Proceed, Mr. Micawber.
In appearing before you to denounce the most consummate villain that has ever existed, I ask no consideration for myself. None.
Give me that!
Approach again, infamy, and if your head be human, I'll break it. Come on, then. Come on. The emoluments, in consideration of which I entered the service of Heap, were of such infinitesimal size that I was compelled to obtain from him a series of loans, which were given to me on condition that I perform certain services in connection with the falsification of the books.
Liar!
At first, overcome by the pressing need to provide for my rising family, I entered into his little schemes. However, as I slowly began to comprehend the full nature, scope, and significance of his Machiavellian dreams, they became so revolting to me that I decided to expose them.
You shall prove this, you Copperfield.
Ask Heap, Mr. Traddles, who lived in his house after he left it.
You did, you fool, and still live there.
Ask Heap, Mr. Traddles, if he ever kept a notebook. Ask Heap if he ever burnt one, and if he says yes and asks you where the ashes are, refer him to Wilkins Micawber.
You found nothing. Nothing!
Nothing? You recognize this then, you heap of infamy? A memorandum of your crimes in your own hand. My charges against this heap are as follows. First, obtaining Mr. Wickfield's signature, the documents of importance representing them to be documents of no importance.
I have kept for Wickfield his name and reputation.
Second, with systematically forging the signature of Mr. Wickfield to enter his books and documents in sundry ways and fashions.
I have kept for Wickfield his very house and home.
A page of trial signatures written by Heap and carelessly consigned to the rubbish bin. Third, that Mr. Wickfield has been for years deluded and plundered by Heap, as an examination of the royal books of the firm will show.
They are gone!
They are.
Some thief has stolen them!
I did, and posted them to T. Traddles, barrister at law, 3 days ago.
Heap, you will make restitution to the last farthing. To Miss Trotwood, Mr. Wickfield, and others. All books and papers will remain in our possession, and you will keep to your room until they've been thoroughly examined.
Is that Copperfield, no tongue? I won't do it!
Copperfield, step round to the guild hall and bring back two officers.
Mr. Dick, would you be so good as to take this heap and see that he stays in his room until we're ready for him?
You have never liked me, Copperfield, as I have liked you. You've always been against me. Micawber, I'll pay you.
Congratulations, sir.
Over here.
Turtles.
Thank you, young Copperfield.
Oh, Mr. Micawber, how can we ever thank you?
The cloud has passed from my mind, ma'am, and that is my thanks. I am restored to my fellow creatures, and that is my thanks. If Mrs. Micawber and I will once again tread the endless path of pecuniary involvement, makes me almost lightheaded. Welcome, poverty. Welcome, misery.
Tell me, Mr. Micawber, have you never thought of emigration?
Emigration, ma'am?
Yes, just starting life afresh. Say, in Australia.
Madam, it was the dream of my youth, the fallacious aspiration of my riper years. But without capital, what can be done?
Well, you've done so much for us, we can do a little for you.
If you could provide a loan, say, on my notes of hand.
Could? Can and shall, Mr. Micawber.
My dear Copperfield, I entertain the conviction that upon that distant shore, something of an extraordinary nature will turn up.
Dora! Sweet! You promised you wouldn't come down.
I'll fetch the doctor, Doc.
Don't be angry with me.
I'm angry, my angel. I just blame myself for having left you.
Quite alone.
What's it?
No.
They should have valued her for the qualities she had, not those she didn't have. Oh, God, forgive me for that, because I loved her. And I still do. How is the pattern of our lives made, Agnes? But some must be forever turning sorrow into strength, while others simply begin with joy.
Steerforth.
Oh,
Dora. Yes, Dora.
Mentioned Dora and Steerforth together. But you were her friend.
Well, David, of course I was her friend. I know your life has been hard, but you are what you are because of it. Oh, talk of Steerforth's gifts, talents, but you have a greater gift. You have the gift for life, survival, for always rising, never going under. I put Steerforth and Dora together because they were both children. Their lives were easy, effortless, thoughtless, flawed through and through because they were weak and never hardened properly. Now, David, listen to me, please. The best steel must go through the fire.
You make Dora's death sound like a matter for quiet celebration.
No.
What good can come from Dora's death?
What good can possibly come from Dora's death?
No one loved that child more than I. As pretty, as warm, as good-hearted a creature as you'll meet this side of the grave. But she was not for him. Not for David Copperfield. And he was not for her. They would have found it out before long. They were on the point of finding it out when she died. Had she lived, that marriage would have turned into an arid, sterile union that would have poisoned both their lives and made them miserable ever after. Now, he's free. He can remake his own life, if he will. Poor Dora. Well, she's gone.
And that's the end of it.
Safe journey, ma'am.
Well, goodbye, young Copperfield. Remember your friends miss you. Of course, we can get along without you, you know, but, well, we'd rather not.
I wish with all my heart you hadn't come. Now I wish you wouldn't leave.
I shall be in Dover if you have need of me.
I have need of you now. Agnes, there's something I've always wanted to ask. What did you and Dora speak of the night she died?
That was between us. God bless you, David.
Gear up there!
Loved him.
again. Walking the beach, watching the sea. Will I always be alone? Buried somewhere under all these memories? To know if I may be the hero of my own life or forever its victim. Little Emily, life was no kinder to you.
Mr. Peggotty, it won't be her, you know.
Maybe, but I've been on a score of journeys like this one, and there'll be a score of others. One more ain't going to make no difference.
Every blessing and success, Mrs. Micawber.
I feel confident, dear Mr. Copperfield, that Australia is the legitimate sphere of activity for Mr. Micawber.
I'm certain of it.
I do not as yet allude to the governorship of the colony, merely to the right opportunity.
I only hope the journey will not prove to be too tedious for you.
My dear Copperfield, you provided us with delightful company, a young lady who will be a comfort to Mrs. Micawber, and a man after my own heart, an old sea salt, with whom I can discuss the proper navigation of the vessel. Perhaps even drop a word of advice in the ear of the captain.
We shall, sir, if need be.
You know, Copperfield, I have a distinct presentiment that something of an extraordinary nature is about to turn up.
The corbeau, the luggage.
Yeah, probably so.
Come along, little one.
Good luck. Watch out, Mr. Micawber, won't you?
Don't you worry. He's going to be all right. We all are.
Well, Emily?
You've done this for me.
I know.
It's for Ham. Asking him to forgive me.
He already has. I'll take it down to Yarmouth for him. You know that Steerforth's been seen in London. They say he's asking for you. By all accounts, he's in a desperate mood. For all the wrong he did you, I think he truly loves you.
Everybody strongly, they use the march to great length.
I thought it was. Anything, Steerforth, you could have done anything. Reach the stars! Waste. Waste. Waste or waste. Life asks more of us. Demands it. It's not enough to be talented, Steerforth, or beautiful, Dora, or even simply loving. Yes, Mother, or even simply loving. We must
be strong. Or else the gifts that God sends us into the world with will just fade and wither in the first cold wind that blows on us.
The gift for life, the gift for life, the best steel.
Must go through the fire. Yes. Yes. Chapter 1. I am born. Whether I shall turn out to be the hero of my own life, or whether that station will be held by anyone else, these pages must show. To begin my life with the beginning of my life, I recall that I was born on a Friday at 12 o'clock at night. It was remarked that the clock began to strike and I began to cry simultaneously. In consideration of the day and hour of my birth, it was declared by the nurse, first, that I was destined to be unlucky in life, and secondly, that I was...